Am I audible now? Am I audible now? Yes. Okay, audible. Okay, okay. I'm so sorry, guys. I'm so sorry. There was some problem, I guess. So my voice was not coming. So I'll start whatever I had said. So basically, this is about sociology answer writing. And I assume anyone appearing in 2021 mains out here? UPSC mains 2021? Abhishek Singh 2023, 2022, okay. Okay, so I assume all of you that are present here, you people are appearing for 2020. Rahul, you're appearing for 2021. Means. Okay. So not much time left, Rahul. So I assume you've completed your sociology optional syllabus. Okay, great. So have you started your answer? Okay. Have you started your answer writing? Okay. So this is basically where we're going to talk about the essentials of answer writing and the first class of, okay. We'll address all of that, Rahul. And I'll take all of your queries. This is not a class, my dear. I'm going to take a session and then I'll talk about the Diademy answer writing program. And you can join that. This is not a class. There we'll have live discussion of answers and all these things. But I'll come to that slowly. So initial 30-40 minutes, I'll talk about how to approach answer writing in sociology in UPSC. And then I'll open it to your queries. Okay, so without delay, let's start. Right. I'll just share my screen. Yes, there's actually a puja in my locality, my dear. I'm really sorry. So you have to bear with that. I really can't help it. Okay, so this is about the basics of sociology answer writing. So all those who are appearing for 2022 and 2023, I assume that you have gone through basic textbooks like NCRTs, at least the NCRTs of sociology. So in case someone hasn't, then that is also not an issue. But this is about sociology answer writing mainly, so we'll deal with that. You can obviously learn how to write answers and then you can start with your syllabus. So it's either way is beneficial for all. Anyone from West Bengal, who has come here for sociology optional in WBCS? Anyone? Anyone has come for WBCS sociology answer writing? Priyanka. Okay, Priyanka, see, this is mainly about UPSC, but at the end of the session, I'll also address your queries regarding WBCS. Okay, 5-10 minutes we'll keep for WBCS sociology also. See, the basic subject remains the same and doesn't change. Only the pattern of questions, answer, how to write an answer, because in UPSC you have a fixed word limit. In WBCS, you are long answers are preferred. So that's the only difference. Your basic theories and how you have to approach a question, that doesn't change. So it's obviously beneficial for both the students of both the exams. Okay, so without delay, let's start. Okay, sociology in UPSC. We have two papers, 250 marks each. First paper is going to deal with, I hope all of you have gone through the syllabus. So first paper is mainly about sociological theories and different thinkers, mainly Western thinkers. You don't have Indian thinkers here because sociology as a subject, it emerged in Europe. It was a product of the Renaissance. So we'll talk, the first paper deals with how it emerged, it was a product of Renaissance, how changes were happening, intellectual changes were happening, there were certain mercantilism came and all these things, and how sociology emerged. And we come to know about Saint Sasimo and August Koth, and then how your Durkheim and Marx and all these people come. That is your first part. Then you have, what is the difference between sociology and common sense? What is sociology's comparison? What is, so how you can compare sociology and anthropology, sociology and economics, sociology and polity? What is how one contributes to the other? So that this is your first part. Then you come to your thinkers. Among thinkers in UPSC, you have Durkheim, Marx, and Weber. And then you have Parsons, Merton, Mead. I think that's all you have for UPSC. Then you have theories, different theories of social stratification. Then you have kinship, family, marriage, all these things. Then you have social change and development. There you come across different development and displacement functions and all these different theories related to development, how the Percot periphery theory, how this, your Latin American countries, despite being very resource rich, are lying on the periphery, and all the European countries are taking away the resources, development, displacement, all these things. Apart from that, you have a part, sociology and I think scientific changes, that part you have. So this is more or less about your paper one. Next, we come to paper two. Paper two is entirely about Indian sociology. Here, you'll mainly learn thinkers like how sociology emerged in India. Initially, it was social anthropology, because when these, in Bombay University, sociology as a discipline, it was started. And Govind Sadasiv Ghure was the first, he's known as the father or the doyen of Indian sociology. And he started primarily, it was these British anthropologists who started taking interest in Indian society. You have people like Verrier, Olwin, and all these people who started taking, so it emerged as an anthropological discipline. Then Ghure brought in the Indological approach. Like he said that in order to study Indian society, you cannot look at, because what these Western people were, these Westerners did was, they had their own understanding. They tried to impose their Western theories on India. So Ghure was against it. He felt that no, Indian sociology has to be understood from Indian perspective. You have to go back to your ancient, your Puranas, your Vedas, your Upanishads, and then from there you have to, how this triad emerged, like this Brahma and Vishnu and Maheshwar, how this emerged and how Indian society changed. And then he has different theories. So his approach is known as the Indological approach. Next comes M.N. Srinivasan, who was a student of Ghure, but he slightly differed. He said that no, only depending on texts will not do. We cannot solely depend on the book view, like what is written in book. So we have to depend on, we have to go to the field, we have to, we have to conduct field studies and we have to pick up data. So he started the field view in Indian sociology. That was started by M.N. Srinivasan, and he conducted studies. And his famous book is Remembered Villages, and he brought about concepts of westernization and Sanskritization, all these theories of social change and all these things. Then you have A.R. Desai, who's a Marxist historian. He speaks about how the Indian national, the struggle for Indian independence was essentially a struggle for these, were struggle among these different economic classes, like these farmers versus these landowners and so on. So he studies from a Marxian perspective. And next you have other Indian sociologists like Andre Bete and his study of the Tanjore village. Then other things that you have in this paper is caste and tribe difference between these. What Ghure speaks on caste, he says that Varna is not different from caste and all these things. How M.N. Srinivas differentiates that. Next you have, I think, different classes, the Indian middle class, then you have the working class, the industrial class, and all these things. Apart from that, you have your current issues, I think. That's more or less about the syllabus. And as I said, there will be two papers, 250 each. So moving on. Yes, research methods, right, Sahil. research methods, like which method is better, which is used for what, you what is the benefits of participant observation, and all these methodologies and all these things. So that constitutes a very, that is again a very not much variation and only a very static part. You don't you don't have that much of current affairs or analysis in that. Yes, you can tweak in a little bit of studies here and there, some important studies where such kind of methods have been used, and which is good for what, where you need case study method, where you need your participant observation, where you need covert observation, where you need overt observation, where you need your empirical methods, the positivist method, where you need non-positivist methods, and all these things. Second paper is all about implications of the first paper. Not really. Here you have to deal with Indian sociologists. It's not about implications of the first paper solely. But yes, first paper will hold a very, very big importance. So unless you have understood your first paper, second paper is going to be very, very difficult, because first paper will form your base. Only then you can move on to your second paper. So anyone preparing for sociology, you have to study, you have to be very, very thorough with your thinkers. Your functionalist approach of Durkheim and your Marx and your Weber, these has to be on your fingers, on your fingertips. Okay, moving on. Question pattern. So there are 8 questions. You have to attempt 5 questions in all. And these 5 will have subparts. I think all of you have gone through the previous year question paper in UPSC. So there are 2 questions out of which, out of these 5, 2 are compulsory, and 3 you can write any out of the rest. So your section B, first question, will have 5 parts. 150, that's 10 marks for each subpart. 10 into 5, 50. And the word limit is 150 for each question. Apart from that, you have to write any other 2 questions from section A, that the division will be like 20-20-10. Again, 20-20-10 for other 2 questions. Then you move on to your section B. Section B will again have the first question compulsory, which is again 5 questions, 5 subparts, A, B, C, D, E. 10 marks each, 150 marks. And your 20-20-10 will be, you'll be given one and a half page. Like, it will be like the page where the question is written, that page, then the other page. That will be for, like, you'll be given 2 pages roughly. So more or less, you cannot write till the end. So you have to fit your answer within 1.5 to 1.75. So like more or less in 2 pages, you have to fit in your answer for 150 words. So it has to be 150 words. There the word limit is given. And for the other, for your 20 marks, you'll be given 3 pages. So you have to fit in your 2.5 page. So it will be roughly 2 point, like just like in your GS, you have like the space that is given. So it has to be 250 words. So 250 to try to keep it within 250. So as I said, the compulsory questions will have 5 subparts, 150 words, 10 marks each. And other questions, 3 subparts, like your question number 2 and 3 will have 3 subparts, 20, 20, 10. For your 20 marks, you will have 3 pages. For your 10 marks, you'll have 2 pages. So that's how you have to go about. Any doubts still here? Any doubts still here? Okay, moving on. What may be the best resource or book list? We can talk about it later. Actually, this is mainly about answer writing. So we are not dealing with exclusively about book list, but I'll definitely tell you at the end of the session. Now, next we'll come to what are the requirements of a good answer. So you have to write such an answer so that the examiner is really, really impressed by your answer. Kindly pardon, there's a lot of noise. Can you hear me properly? can you hear me? Okay. Just give me a second. There's a lot of noise. Okay, so what are the requirements of a good answer? First is your introduction. So we know that any standard answer has three parts, an introduction, a body, and a conclusion. And first is your introduction. So it has to be very relevant to the context. For example, if you are writing about, say you are asked a question, discuss the contributions of G.S. Gure in Indian sociology, or discuss the Indological method of studying Indian society. So if you start writing like Indian sociology emerged in the 20th century as a part of as social anthropology or something, okay, that is a very vague starting. The examiner knows that, okay, you have studied, and that's why you're trying to put anything anywhere. You don't know what to write. You've studied, it's okay, it's good, but you don't know what to write with. So you have to start your answer with something that is very relevant to the question. And you have to say, for example, discuss the Indological method. So if you write that, how did the Indological method come? So the Indological method can be attributed to G.S. Gure, who took this method, which deals with studying of Indian society by study of ancient scriptures like our Vedas or our Puranas. So it essentially adopts a book view. Then you have that, make a paragraph, or you write, give a subheading like contributions of the Indological method or emergence of Indological method, and then underline that or make a box, and then you write in point wise. So, you know, when you write answers like that, that creates a very good impression in the mind of the examiner. Or for example, you are told to write about say something in paper one. What do you mean by social stratification? So if something is given like that, and what are the what is its relevance in the social context today, in today's social context? Like, do you think we still live in a stratified society? So you can't start with something vague. You have to start with, social stratification is a form of inequality where people are divided on the basis of caste or whatever, different segregations, where there are segregated, where there are man-made segregations. So it has to be very precise, very to the point, and very relevant to the context, not something unnecessary. Just because you've read something, that doesn't mean that you have to put it into your answer. Next is body. Body has to be very well constructed, addressing all dimensions. Say you have a question on what do you mean by new farmers movement? And do you think there is any significant difference between the new farmers movement and the old farmers movement? So first thing that you have to address is farmers movement, or you can give a historical context in the introduction, like how farmers movement in India, like you're asked the question on in the Indian perspective. So you have to start with like farmers movement has a history in the pre-British in the British era, and it has been continuing since then. Or you can give some other some recent event. So you can start with a historical, say you're given something to compare, that do you think it's a new phenomena or do you think that it's old? So you can basically give a introduction which is based on your historical context. See, when it's given, something is given, like you have to compare between two things, new and old. So it's better to give a historical context. Or you can start with some recent, like recent times farmers movement has gained much momentum owing to issues like that. However, this is not a new phenomena. You can start like that. Okay. Or you can start with some report, but that depends. Some report or according to this or according to that, like that, you can start. Now, next, coming to the body. It says that, what do you mean by new farmers movement? When this is being asked, what do you mean by new farmers movement? So you have to address this part first. That new farmers movement is farmers movement that is taking place in the post-liberalization era. And there are certain, they are called new farmers movement because they are having certain dimensions or certain issues that are different from the farmers movement that were traditionally taking place. Like in British India, these farmers movements, you have your Eka movement, your Mopla movement, or number of peasant movements, Bardoli Satyagraha, and all these things. Like, then you have to use your knowledge in history. So in these things, you'll see that it was mainly on, it was the state versus these landless farmers who were cultivating, who were basically tenants. And they were not, it was against oppressive rents and all these things. It can also be seen in the Mughal times also. That's why there's an extensive experiments. These Mughal rulers, and even before that, Sultanate kings and all ancient kings, they used to do a lot of experiments with land revenue system, like your Batai and Ghalla Baksh system. Someone said the Sikandari, the Gaza for measuring land and all these things. You don't have to write all that. So land revenue was very important. But how is this new farmers movement different? It is different because here we are not fighting the state. We are fighting, suddenly there's liberalization. I'm sure all of you know about the LPG reforms. So suddenly there are corporate forces and our technology is not much developed. We are suddenly having an ushering in of new things. There were certain changes in Indian agriculture post-Green Revolution. A portion of the peasantry benefited and they were mainly large farmers. The large and middle farmers, the lower strata did not benefit. And in the post-LPG reforms, these people, they suddenly have to face these corporate forces. And since a lot of people are dependent on agriculture, so that is creating a kind of social tension. So the post-LPG reforms, these farmers who are protesting are not poor people. They are not landless tenants. They are the rich, the middle or the richer farmers, right? So these are the dimensions that you have to add in your answer. So it has to address all the things. So first I said, what is new farmers movement? You have to write the features of the new farmers movement. Again, how is it different? So how is in while addressing how is it different, you have to tell that why is it different? As I said, that these are old farmers, not the landless people. They are the rich and the middle level farmers. They're not the poor landless laborers. So this is one major difference. There would be other differences. Their ways of revolution has changed. Like for example, they go and protest in front of the Jantar Mantar. Okay, so they are more organized. They are not scared of facing the state, the form of the state. Previously the state can go and do anything on the farmers, but now it's changed. They are also having different activists with them. So you have to address it, why new farmers are different. You're being asked, the question is asked, are these new farmers movements different from your old? So you have to, in one part you have to write, yes, they are different. And in the other part, you have to write how they are not different. Like the presence of activists or all these things. They were there. Gandhi was there. Sardar Patel was there in 1920s. And now also you have activists. So this part has not changed. So this is how you have to address all the portions. Shubham, can we have some introduction templates prepared on recurring topics? If yes, from where to prepare it? Shubham, in our answer writing program, we'll be giving to the students some templates. So it'll be like you don't have to prepare it yourself since time is very short for people who are preparing. So we'll be giving these templates. So you just have to go through them and you can use them in your answers. Right. Next, conclusion. Conclusion has to be a very well roundup. Conclusion is your summary. So your conclusion should address everything that has been said. Say your conclusion would be around 30% of your, like if you are, if the word limit is 150, it should be, your conclusion should be 15 to 20 words, not a very long one. For 250, 300 words, it can be around 25 words. So it has to say something that is very relevant, that something that sums up your answer, that at one some point you agree that yes, new farmers, revolutions are new ones. At some point, you also feel that, yes, there are elements of, so it is a change as well as a continuation of the old movements. So something like that. And you have to give a very well roundup answer. So these are the requirements of a good answer, primarily the requirements of a good answer. Next, we'll come to how we can enrich it further, right? So these are the three basic things. So if any of these three are missing, an introduction is missing, your body is, say you are just answer like what are the features of a new farmer's revolt and don't answer how is it different, or you write how is it different and don't address how it is not different, because the question is asking do you think, then it's not a well constructed addressing all the dimensions, a good body, there you're liable to lose marks. And conclusion again, so sometimes in a hurry, we just write introduction and body and then we don't write the conclusion. We feel that, okay, we've written, but that also carries a separate marks. And your, no matter how good an introduction and body you've written, if you don't write a proper conclusion or you don't, or you miss out on your conclusion, then you are liable to lose marks. So this is very, very important. I hope this is clear. Any doubts till now? Okay, moving on. So now I'll come to some tips for writing a good answer. First is understanding of different sociological perspectives. So what do you mean by sociological perspective? For example, what is sociology? Or it's a study of society. So who is society? You, me, our domestic help, the people of the transgender community who comes and visits our house during some birth of child or during some marriages. someone's mic is unmute. Kindly mute yourself. Right. How to connect current affairs with topic, or how to use current affairs in answer writing. Yes, Sahil, we'll come to that. The next slide is on that. I'll come to that. So you have to understand, please mute yourself because it creates a disturbance. NLV Kumar, kindly mute yourself. So you have to understand the sociological perspective. So among your thinkers, so you have to be very thorough with your thinkers. And when you think, different thinkers have put forward different views. For example, the functionalist school, they feel that man is a product of society. Society was not born out of man's behavior. Man was a product of society. So according to the functionalist perspective, for example, when we go for, say, I'm from Bengal, so say we have the Durga Puja as a big celebration. So when we have that Durga Puja celebration, when people gather at the pandals and you have this aarti and all these things, Durkheim says that is where, when religion is born. So religion is nothing, but he deals with collective conscience. The society is a product of the collective conscience of people. So that is about the functionalist perspective. Pardon, the spelling is wrong. It's the functionalist, F-U-N-C. Next, you have Marxist school. Marx says that, your economy is your base. And on that lies your superstructure. Your superstructure is your politics, your society, your other social forces, your religion, everything has a economic basis to it. So there is an underlying class struggle that is going on in the society, and that is the base. So economy is the base. So everything, so for example, when I was talking of A.R. Desai of Paper 2, so he said that the Indian National Movement was essentially, he ignored all the other aspects, the cultural aspect and all these things of Indian National Movement. And he said that it was essentially a struggle for between economic forces. The British were imperialists. They wanted to capture economic resources. And there were these natives, the agricultural class and different classes of people who were being exploited, and they were fighting for their rights. So this forms the core of the Indian National Movement. So that is how the Marxist school defined. Similarly, you have the Weberian school. They have their own, the feminist school, the postmodern school. They have different. The subaltern school, which mainly deals with these marginalized people and all these things. For example, recently you must have read in Current Affairs that the Bhima Koregaon battle, so the sociological interpretation, the subaltern school, they said that the Bhima Koregaon battle was not a battle where these Mahar castes were supporting the British against these Marathas. So it was not that something, and there was riots because these people were basically Bhima Koregaon battle anniversary was being celebrated, and there were riots in Maharashtra because they said that these Mahar class they supported the British despite being Indians, they supported the British against their own brethren, against their own countrymen. But the postmodern school would say that no, it was essentially it was a fight for their own caste identity. These Mahars were downtrodden. They were looked down upon. They were considered untouchables and outcasts. Mahars are these people who clear people the sewerage. They are these manual scavengers, this class. So they were looked down. And these Marathas, they were Chitpavan Brahmins, the highest class. And they were looked down upon, the society. So it was a fight for their class identity. So it was not a fight against like they were supporting the imperialist forces. That is not the right way to look at it. They were fighting for their class identity. So that's how the subaltern school has their own way of putting things. So sociological perspective, for example, you have to see if the first and the foremost thing that a sociologist does is, Why I am saying all these things? Because I don't want you to get into rote learning. For example, your paper 2 will be application based. No matter how many things you study, how many things you, whatever questions you mug up and you model answers you learn, that is not enough. Because the questions asked in UPSC will never be something that you have practiced. So you have to take your understanding. You have to take your understanding of thinkers and all these things, and you have to develop a sociological thought, and then you can understand it. For example, if you're asked a question, that's by understanding. See, a common man, anyone sitting at a tea stall, you know, they say a lot of theories. Like two people just conversing amongst each other, they say a lot of things. For example, they say that these days, divorces are very common because today's women are, they are too modern. There's a lot of influence of Western society. That is what we see around us. So that is common sense. Is that sociology? Is that sociology? You think anything that you see is sociology? No, that is not sociology. Divorces are common not because of Western influences. There are multiple factors. That's because women have become economically independent. So marriage as an institution, the dependence of a wife on her husband for economic means is no longer relevant. And that is one of the prime reasons. So here you have to write that according to Marxist scholars, you can write like Marx says, defines everything. See, here the thing is, you don't know which Marxist scholar has said, but you know that the argument would be on these lines. So if a particular issue is given to you, you can obviously, you know what Marxist school will say, you know what functionalist school will say, you know what feminist school will say. So you can use these, like, according to Marxist scholars, doesn't matter, you don't know which Marxist scholar has said. It's not possible to remember the names and what which scholar said what. There's lots of research. But they argue on these lines, that it's because that economic dependence has become, of a woman on a man has reduced. So they have become independent. And based on that, the society is fragmenting. Family as a concept, or, marriage is a concept, marriage as an institution is weakening. So it is not only because of cultural factors, like suddenly people, because you will get to hear, if you look around, you go to a, anyone having, I'm mostly using English, but I hope everyone's okay with it. Otherwise, I can also switch to Hindi. Anyone who's not, Hindi sabko samajh mein aati hai, or yeah, there are people who have problems in Hindi, understanding Hindi. Okay, Rahul has no issue, right? Okay. So, no problem, right? So, agar aap, say aap kisi chai ki dukaan pe jaate ho, ya you go to some, weddings mein ye sab baatein bahut chalti hai. Like, people will just make a statement ki aaj kal ki shaadiyan aisi ho gayi hai, waisi ho gayi hai. People have, aaj kal shaadiyon mein wo mera ek 5-6 saal reh lo and then people divorce, kyunki aaj kal log MTV zyada dekhte hai and all these things. Aisi baatein chalti hai. But that is not sociology. I don't know Hindi. Okay, English, right? Okay. So these are the things that is common sense. So in your first unit, when you study emergence of sociology, there is a very important thing that you study is sociology and common sense. So all that you see around people discussing so many things, that is not... that is common sense. A sociologist will think from a different angle. He'll try to analyze society from a different angle, right? Like, for example, many days back, I think a year or two back, on Facebook, I saw, we know God created man, right? But is it not so that man also created God? Yes or no? Like, humko kaise pata? Like, how does, a particular deity look. Wo hamara imagination mein to hai. Like we've imagined that God, Lord Shiva looks like this. Goddess Parvati looks like this, or whatever you have. Ma Durga looks like this. So man has also created God through his imagination, and God has also created man. So that's how a sociologist think. So you have to develop that sociological thinking. Right. Yes. So this is how, and how you can develop sociological thinking, you have to be very thorough with your thinkers. You have to know what these people are thinking, how these people are, what the functional school says, what Marxist school says, what the Weberian school says. Like when you study Weber, all those I've already studied, you will get to know that he said that capitalism was not essentially only because people had money. It was also the religious ethic, like it developed in Western societies because this particular religion called Protestantism that developed, they put forth a very rigid, they were very rigid. They wanted this. They said that if people led a very disciplined life, only then they'll go to heaven. So, but who goes to heaven, no one knows. Only some people will go to heaven. So everyone was forced to lead a very disciplined life. So they went on accumulating money. And that is how capitalism developed. So that is called sociological thinking. It's not just like that. For example, sociological interpretation of social distancing. Feminists will say, what has social distancing led to? What is the sociological impact of all this COVID protocol and all these things? On a good side, you have said that this has reduced, sexual harassment in public places because people have to maintain social distancing. Marxist perspective would say that due to this social distancing, these people are no longer can go gather for protests. So in that way, it's a win-win situation for the haves and the have-nots, or the people, the laborers, or whoever other in the weaker section. They cannot protest because gathering is not allowed. So that's how you analyze a particular. So social distancing on the face of it is what? Just to stop the spread of COVID. But it has different sociological interpretations. Are you getting my point? All my friends present here, are you getting, guys, what I am trying to say? Preeti, okay. Okay, others, are you getting my point? How you have to develop a sociological understanding. And if you develop this, only then you can write good answers. You have to analyze things on your own. You will be given like the sociological impact of demonetization. I think this came in 2018 or some question. You about the Me Too movement. The sociological interpretation of Me Too movement. Me Too movement, we know that there were people coming, women coming on open forum and talking about sexual harassment that has happened. What it has done, when you read your manifest and latent functions of Merton, then the manifest function is like people coming, women coming against and speaking for their rights. The latent function is, it also acts as a deterrent that no one, that today if you are coming and there is a naming and shaming exercise going on social media. So if today my colleague is named for doing something wrong with a female colleague, tomorrow I might be named and shamed. So that is the latent function that it is serving, something that is not seen. So here you can use Merton's theory of manifest and latent functions. Clear? Again, analysis of issues from the sociological angle. Good use of keywords. I think I've already explained this. Analysis of issues from sociological angle, like child labor, women-centric schemes. What is the sociological angle of, say, Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao? If you're told, it will lead to women empowerment. That is one thing. It will reduce your domestic, it will also reduce domestic violence. It will lead to greater capacity building. So you have to think beyond just not what is typically visible. It will lead to economic empowerment, and it will lead to, you know, it will give a, it will reduce the gender gap of labor. So this is, these are the keywords that you have to use. Or you are using your, say you're reading Srinivas, and you say that how westernization and Sanskritization helped to change the society. So if you don't say that while writing something, that it was a change in itself and not a change, it was not a change in itself, or it was only a change for itself, or it was change within, not a total change, or within the structure. So if you don't use these keywords, or you don't, for Marx, you don't say, use concepts like class in itself becomes class for itself. Or for Durkheim, you don't write collective consciousness. If you don't use such keywords, then it doesn't make sense. You can spend paragraphs writing different answers, but if you don't address one, something that can be written in one word, see, class in itself becomes a class for itself. You have to write in half page, and yet you don't know, and the examiner doesn't know. You have to be very crisp. You have to, whenever you write a class in itself becomes a class for itself, or you write that what Sanskritization did, that there was a change in structure. It was not a change in structure. Sorry, it was a change in structure, but not a change of structure. So if you don't write in, while criticizing M.N. Srinivas's thing, so this one keyword actually summarizes everything. And if you don't write that, you can write pages or you can write paragraphs, but your examiner will just give you very average marks. So this is how you make your answer very different. Okay, moving on. Integration of theory with recent issue. For example, this is very important. I think someone was asking how to integrate. For example, you have to ask that how, you have to, I think this is one of the previous year questions. I don't remember the year. Problems of IT workers. So these IT workers are like, you know, these, say they have to make a report. Say someone, what would I say? Someone's, some IT company, say Wipro or TCS, they have to do some analysis or something for some foreign client. Someone is working behind the product testing. Someone is doing some that, I like, whatever be the process. You, some may, many of you have worked in IT companies, so you might be knowing. So what is the final product? Can you know, one engineer say that whatever was the, whatever the outcome, it was, it, it is entirely mine. It is entirely mine. Can you say that? No, because I'm ending, I'm working in one small portion of the work. I'm doing one small portion of the work. The other person is doing the other part, the integration part. Other is running simulations. So you're bound to face frustration because you are alienated from your product. Clear? You are alienated. What you are doing, you don't know. What, like, you are the thing that comes, say you're made to make a report. Say Goldman Sachs is given a project where they have to analyze, you know, level of urbanization in class one cities in India, or, you know, how like urban lifestyles or something like that, or housing pattern or something like that. Someone is collecting the data. Someone is tabulating the data. Some is doing your mean median mode calculations. Some other one is doing some, running some other, you know, simulations. So can I say, and then finally someone is compiling and the other is presenting the report to the, say the Ministry of Urban Affairs. Now, can you say that this entire job, that's this entire thing that was done belongs to one person? Can you say that? Please reply in the chat box. Please keep engaging. Don't fall off to sleep. Can you say that any one particular worker can claim that, okay, this belongs to me, this report was done by me? Absolutely no. And this is your concept of alienation, that the worker cannot say, well, how this thinking, how this, when Marx was writing, there were no IT companies. So what happened was, when Industrial Revolution was taking place in Europe, there were these assembly line production, you know, assembly line production. For example, you have it in many industries, like, you know, like it's like a conveyor belt. Okay, you have seen conveyor belts in airports. One is doing one part, maybe say a cloth industry. Someone is doing, separating the thing from the yarn. Some is doing the other thing. The other person is doing the other thing. And finally, when the cloth is made, because Industrial Revolution was essentially centered around the textile industry. So finally, when the thing is made, the worker cannot say that this is the outcome of my labor. So he felt alienated. The same thing is happening to today's IT workers. And that is why there's so much of frustration. That's why they need, you know, so many people in the IT industry are committing suicide. So many people are leaving the job at the age of 40 and they are going in the hills and doing organic farming. So this is the reason of this frustration. Also, you're making a product. The person working in Mercedes-Benz, he's an automobile engineer. He's working in the Mercedes-Benz company, but he is, when the car is made, the car is priced at some crore. And the poor employee who has worked behind, who the engineer, the automobile engineer, who has put his brains into it, he is not paid enough money to buy that Mercedes-Benz. So that creates an alienation. My product, but I cannot use it. So that creates a, you know, creates a sense of alienation. So that's how you have to integrate it. Now, religion in modern society, what is the role of religion in modern society? That you can, like, you know that everything has a function. The functionalist perspective says that everything has a function in the society. So they don't talk of dysfunctions. They only talk of functions. Like modern day, what is the function of religion in modern day? People have, religion has become very in urban societies, if you in big cities, religion has become a very personal affair. In villages, you go, you see people will gather at a festival, there's a fair and all these things. But in urban societies, like where societies are primarily like much urbanized, in big cities, say in Mumbai, Delhi, Kolkata, and all these things, people are very busy in their lives. So they don't have that solidarity. They don't have the time to gather at a temple at one time. So it has become a very private affair. In its place, what has come up, different denominations. You have these and sects. I think you have a few days back, I think a few years back, there was this Ram Rahim case, you know, and there were many rich people who were his disciples. So there are many. He was a corrupt one, but he's in serving jail terms, but not every, all of them are. So what is happening is our problems have become more complicated. In villages, people have more or less similar kind of problems, like maybe they are poor people, they don't have means to buy a plot of land or something. All are tenants, so they have a similar kind of problems, or they are all suffering from some kind of natural calamity. All of them fear drought or flood, so they go and together they pray so that the drought, the rain gods bless them and there is no drought. But our problems in urbanized societies, it has become very complicated. So for example, some are fighting deadly diseases like cancer. Some are fighting, maybe the child has gone into drugs. For some other, it's some other problem. So our problems are different. So we cannot go and share our problems, or we can go and pray together. So what we can do is, we take the help of these, we go and visit these ashrams and these babajis and all these things, because we are looking for inner peace. We are frustrated with our daily lives. We are sad with the kind of work, because there again, we have Marx's concept of alienation and all these things. That's why religion has become a... So this is the role of religion. Religion is we are trying to look for inner solace. It's not that external, that celebration and all. That part of religion is gradually dissipating in urban societies. So religion is becoming a more private affair. So from a functionalist perspective, you have to analyze that way. Work is compartmentalized. Yes, absolutely, Rahul. Very good. Sociological analysis of current issues. I have already discussed the social distancing, how you're going to think. Farmers' movements, labor codes, all these things. Okay. Next. Okay, some other tips. Use of Indian thinkers in paper one and Western thinkers is other. When you are, say you're writing Marxian perspective in paper one, use A.R. Desai also. In paper one, they have asked you to write Marxist theories. But you also write in one point, A.R. Desai, for example, in the Indian context, said the Indian national movement was this. So that will create a very good impression in the mind of the examiner, because he would know that, this person has understood the Marxist perspective, and that's why he can present the entire broader picture. His knowledge is not compartmentalized. Talking of Marx, he'll only speak of Marx. No, he's giving wider examples. You have to somehow, you have to see, the examiner doesn't know you personally. So the only thing by which he can know you is your copy. So you have to, give a piece of your mind to the examiner through your answer script. So you have to give, it's like an, it's like an array of things. Like you have to represent your entire horizon. Like, okay, this much I know about this concept. Only then the examiner will be impressed. Interlinking of topics. So in paper one, using Indian thinkers is very, very important. That will really fetch you good marks. And in paper two, say again, you're writing A.R. Desai, you quote Marx somewhere or some neo-Marxist somewhere. When you're writing Andre Bitte, you quote Max Weber, because he was a Weberian sociologist who believed in Weberian methods. Use of examples, data, facts, wherever possible. So wherever possible, you use these data, facts, say, for example, according to the poverty, global hunger index, you're given something about poverty. So you start with such data that according to global hunger index, this is India's position. Or you use some facts according to the Pew Foundation. So many people report, so many people are followers of staunch Hinduism. Say you have to, you're given something on religious fundamentalism. Or say crimes against women. You quote some NCRB data. Then that gives some extra edge, some gravity to your answer, right? Some facts that according to a study in Singapore, such things have been noticed among workers, or according to a study here and there. So you don't have to worry about these things, that you don't have to break your head over all these things. Be like, where am I going to collect all these things? We are going to compile and we are going to give all of these things in the answer writing program. So with the answer writing program, you'll get everything. How to write a good introduction, how to write, you'll be given templates, how to write a good conclusion, and how you're going to integrate your current affairs. And I think those who are not joined the sociology, Diademy sociology channel, you can join it. We'll be posting regular current affairs, like a current affairs related to sociology and how you can use it with present a sociological interpretation of it. Okay, like how you can use it. For example, some women-centric schemes that women are suffering, so from anemia and all these things. So you can say that it's feminization of poverty, something like that. Such kind of keywords really carry a lot of importance. And again, use of diagrams, for example, to explain, say, Adre Bete's study of Tanjore. This was a question 2018. So you can give that there's a central, you can give a, two circle diagram, like there's one inner circle where the upper castes live, then there's the outer circle where lower castes live, and all this, the core periphery model. Or you can, for example, contribution of common sense to sociology, two circles, and then you can show how sociology is contributing to common sense. Then again, an arrow from below, which shows that what is common sense contribute to sociology. So something like that, that really fetches good marks. And writing in point wise, say you're writing the feminist perspective of some issue, make one paragraph, give a dot, a bullet point, according to feminist scholars, underline the keywords, underline the word feminist scholars and all things. Then again, next, according to Marxist scholars. So you, when you're analyzing different, the same issue from different perspectives, the examiner gets to know that, okay, you have a good grip over your theories, over your things, like your, over the subject, over the ideas that are presented by different thinkers. Okay. How to use current affairs in answer writing? You can use some recent events. For example, the Pegasus. I'm sure all of you know about the Pegasus case that happened. This was this Israeli software which could easily hack phones. So you can use this. There's a postmodern concept of a surveillance society, that we are moving towards a situation where we are, where everything, all of our aspects, all the aspects of our lives are being controlled, it's like a panopticon syndrome. You know what's a panopticon? A panopticon is like, like as if someone is constantly looking at you. It was used in European jails in, I think, in the 17th century, early 16th, 15th century. Like the prisoner, everyone, like the authorities would have a complete surveillance over the prisoner. He could be seen from all angles. That's a panopticon syndrome. So we are moving towards a panopticon society, where a surveillance society. Like imagine once you log into Google and you go and search something. Maybe you go and shop on Myntra, and immediately the next time you log into YouTube, you'll see that the same ad is coming. So someone through AI, through something else, is keeping a track on everything that is happening. We all use these Uber cars. Imagine someone tries to get to know of our movements. He just hacks into these our Uber information, hack into our phones. So he'll get to know, he or she will get to know, like, where we stay, where we go, where, which, what are our whereabouts and all these things. So we are not safe. We are constantly compromising with our privacy. So this is the concept of a surveillance society. It's a very postmodern concept. In modern times, now we are living in the postmodern, where modernity has been, has been surpassed. Now we are moving, and now we are having the perils, the ill effects of modernity. And that is what the postmodern concept says, that we are having a surveillance society. There is ecological degradation. So all that modernity had to give was from the Industrial Revolution and all these things. It's over. Now we are in the postmodern phase. Again, you write from the thinker's perspective. I think we have already discussed this. Like, as I said, that in urban areas, you have the rise of denominations and sects. Like I said, in India, we have these Ram Rahi, Vasaram Bapu, so many fake Babajis and all these things. Because religion, it has become a market for religion. Like, which religion has a better market? Which sect, which denomination has a better market? And this was happening in 70s USA also, and it still does happen. So this has been represented by the sociologists Stark and Bainbridge in their theory. So you have to quote these. And for that, I think Harolambous and Holborn is a very good book. But again, you don't have to break your head over that book. Everything will be covered in the answer writing program. We'll be quoting important thinkers, how to use them, how to integrate with current affairs. So through the model answers, discussion videos and everything. Now we'll see some previous year questions. Anyone has any doubts till so far? Any doubts so far? Now we'll just see how these previous year questions are coming and how we can use these, you can integrate your current and your static, your thinkers, and how your one important aspect that I would want to highlight here is, there are certain questions which might appear like your GS questions, like discuss the new labor code and their impact on formal and informal sector labor in India. See, this could be very much a GS3 answer, but it's not. You've been given this question in sociology. So you have to write from a sociological perspective. You cannot say that the new labor code, it is going to do this, it is going to reduce the benefits. Like, you write your GS3 answers, like benefits of labor code, fixed wage rate, social security and these things. That is not the way you have to write. If you write like that, and this is where maximum students make a mistake. There are most current affairs topics are like, they're overlapping, but you have to give a sociological interpretation here. And that can come only with you if you practice answer writing and sociology. Otherwise, you're bound to make such mistake. Everybody makes such mistakes. Everybody. Because you'll be writing your optionals maybe two to three days after your GS paper, GS3, GS3, GS4. So you are bound to make mistake. So what was the highest score? I think it was around 320. 320. Out of 250. So, and their impact on formal and informal labor in India. So you have to again use your Marxist perspective, how it's going to give social security, how then you have to write your feminist perspective, that it is going to, give social security to women. Also, they are going to, this concept of alienation is going to reduce, because your gig workers and your people who don't have platform workers, they are brought under the same umbrella. Then there's a floor wage. So commodity fetishism is another aspect you can bring about. So you have to use these things. Next, impact of gender division of labor on the development of society. Again, you have this gender division, like some sectors, they don't employ women. Women are mostly, they don't have ownership of land. These are the social facts that you have. Now, how are you going to women are mostly tenants. And even if you see, there is very less representation of women. For example, in parliament, we have around 13 to 14% women. So women in decision making is very, very low. Then women in STEM, only 28%. STEM is your scientific fields, very, very less. Even in the top corporate ladders, you see that mostly it's occupied by men. Women are very, very less. So what is the impact? So you have to say that you have to bring your feminist theories. You have to say that women constitute the reserve army, which is again a Marxian concept, because reserve army means that they are so much occupied. They are the societal structure is such that women are made to occupy the household space. And that is why they cannot come to the mainstream and they can work in the workplace. Then, they have problems of childcare leaves and all these things. So these companies don't hire them because a woman is expected to take childcare leave and maternity leave and all these things. So you have to address from these angles. Please mute your mic. Evaluate the nature and scope of anthropogenic influence on Indian climate. Anthropogenic is man-made influence. So here you cannot write like your GS3 that your CO2 emission will increase, your this is going to increase, it's going to do this, our Paris commitments. No. That's your GS3 paper. You have to write a sociological interpretation. You have to write like nature and the scope of anthropogenic influence. For example, Yamuna is, pollution of the Yamuna River. So the sacredness, in the name of religion, we are also polluting the river. And as a result of which, we are it is causing a harm to a river, which is considered a living entity. That is one. Then stubble burning. The big farmers are taking to stubble burning, and the marginalized class is they are the worst sufferers because they don't have money to go and pursue treatment in these expensive hospitals, private hospitals. Then there is women are the worst sufferers in drought affected areas of Vidarbha and all. Women have to travel on feet in Rajasthan also. They have to travel on feet for miles, and then they have to get water on pitcher. So that's how it's like human interventions that due to pollution and lowering of the water table, we are influencing the Indian climate, and that's why how it's affecting the Indian populace at large. That's how you have to give a sociological interpretation. Now we come to why sociology score dropped this year? Will it be like dragging off recent years? Sociology score, I think the top was scored around 320. So it's not like that. Listen, it's not like that the score dropped or something like that. And depending on what the score would be, you would take up a particular optional. It's not like that. See, if you write good answers with proper analysis, proper quoting of thinkers, proper use of facts and figures and diagrams and all these things, relevant, current affairs, integration of topics, the examiner is bound to give you marks. So it's not like that particular year it has dropped, so I will not take up that optional. This year, some particular optional has benefited, I'll take up that. Again, next year, I'll see that my score has dropped. Then next year, again, I'll change it. That's not the way. Have a grip on a particular optional and you're done. See, for selecting an optional, it's very, very important that you take interest in that subject. You cannot go which is scoring and which is not scoring like that. Every optional is scoring if you write well. That's for sure. And if you are scoring exceptionally, there won't be any scaling also. So as far as I know. So have a grip over issues. Try to analyze. When you read the newspaper, something like 2-3 days back, I think there was an issue of the 1 year quota. They're demanding reservations in Tamil Nadu. So when you read this news, try to analyze it, which theories you can put in here. Okay. So that's how you do a sociological interpretation. Now, how this answer writing program is going to be helpful. So we are obviously providing interlinking of topics with the current issues. Then we'll be having discussion videos. Like you'll be given two questions. There are like two, we have the two questions per day. And every Saturday, like we'll give you topics on that. You'll be asked two questions. You have to submit by 12 p.m. Sorry, a.m. And then you'll be evaluated within 72 hours. The evaluated copy will be there in your dashboard. And also we'll be giving you live evaluation once a week or twice a week as the case may be. You'll come on live sessions and your copy will be evaluated by the evaluator, like where you went wrong, how you can improve it and all these things. Apart from that, on the topics that you have covered from Monday to Friday, Saturday, you will have a sectional test. Sectional test is like your full-length test, or maybe it will be like 250 is a total marks, or 125 marks test. So on whatever syllabus you have covered till Monday to Friday. And you'll have four full-length tests, two on paper one, two on paper two, absolutely flexible whenever you want to write. So this is a total three-month program. And there will be live evaluation, as I said, and we'll be given model answers, PDF form also in the form of videos. We'll discuss the model answers, also give the PDF forms of it. And all current affairs, all intro, how to write good introduction, templates of introduction, conclusion, everything will be, everything will be provided, data, statistics, whatever you have, everything. One-to-one evaluation, as I said. So these are the features of the answer writing program. How scaling works. Scaling is basically, I think, what they do is, I think, they try to bring all the optionals at one parity. Of course, if someone is getting very, very good, the topper or something of a particular, I don't know. This is not a session for discussing like who got how much marks. Foundational course catering, we'll be soon launching foundational courses, depending on of course how many people, like we'll be soon launching it. So for this course the fees is, if you are answer writing, it's a 3-month program. So for answer writing, two questions each plus your sectional test, it's 10,000, and if you pay 2,000 extra, 12,000. It's for 12,000, you have your full length tests as well. So total is 12,000. So that's all about it. And there is one good news for all of you. We are having 1 week free of answer writing for this program, which is starting on 15th. We'll be evaluating your answers. We'll be giving you model answers, discussion videos and everything for free for 1 week. After that, we'll start charging you. So for 1 week, you'll be having it free. So you can grab onto that opportunity, submit your answers and get it evaluated. And then you can go for the paid subscription. So this is a golden opportunity, I feel, for all of you. Because it's very, very important. Not only you can read hundreds and thousands, but our memory space is very limited. So you can only keep relevant information. You cannot go about with so many. You cannot take the entire Haralambus and Holborn in your head and go about, and you'll be able to remember nothing. You can make your notes, but that's unnecessary waste of time. I think there are many notes available. Once we start our foundation course, we'll be obviously giving our own notes. And then I think with the answer writing, you will be getting all the important answers of all the important questions. So that will not at all be an issue. So from there, you'll know how to write answers, what to write, where to stop, where to change paragraph and whatever. So I think that's all about it. Okay. At one what stage one can join this program? Shubham, you can join at any stage. It's starting from 15th November. You can join. Don't think I have to complete the syllabus. Syllabus will be automatically completed. Start first day, you start with sociology and common sense. Pick one source, whatever source you're referring to. Pick from there, like you say, someone refers to the Nitin Sangavan book. See, you don't have to refer to multiple sources. What I'm trying to say is you have to streamline your preparation. So you don't refer to, stick to one source. Say someone refers to Nitin Singhavan, some refer to the Vikas Ranjan notes or whatever notes you have, Upendra Gaur notes or whatever notes you have. You just read it. just read it, read that much portion and see how much you can write. Because it's not like you will bug up for 10 books and then you'll write the best answer. It's not like that. The fact is you have to start. You have to start answer writing and automatically things will fall in place. And I'm saying this from my personal experience. Book list. There are plenty of materials, plenty of materials. You can refer to anyone. You can refer to the Nitin Sanghavan book. You can refer to you can refer to the IGNU materials. See, there are many things on websites where you have, there are many websites where they have given this list, like IGNU, which portion you have to read. But IGNU materials are a little bulky, so you can go for an easier book. Or apart from that, anything, Vikas Ranjan or your Upendra Gaur, Mahapatra notes, there are many, many. There's no dearth of material. Anything you read, stick to one or two sources, one for paper one, one for paper two, and start writing answers. Because other than that, it's of no use. Optional scaling. I am not a pro in this. I don't know how scaling is done, but whatever I know is, I think all optionals that are, I think they somehow try to bring you to one parity so that no particular optional gets extra benefit. Like if for mathematics and all, people get a lot of marks, but maybe in arts disciplines they get less. So they do some way, they do some kind of scaling so that they can be brought at par. That's all. I don't know much on this. Okay, any other queries? Nitin Sanghavan was I think he was a topper. You can write, you can refer to the Nitin Sanghavan book. Read from IGNU. Yes, reading. You can read from IGNU. That's very good, Ravi, but it is very time consuming. Then you have to refer to your own notes. Again, you have to make notes. Do you have that much of time instead of that? And you don't even know what is relevant, what is irrelevant. I can give you the names of the books, but that's not what. Instead, there are many people who have already done this work for you. Why will you refer to it? It will not give you any extra edge. You can refer to, you can obviously read it, but it will only complicate your mind. It can be a secondary source of reference after you've done with your basics. Right. Okay, about WBCS people, any particular thing you wanted to ask Priyanka? Priyanka, are you here? I think those who are preparing for WBCS, we'll be launching after the prelims results, the course. And for WBCS, the main difference is that you have one or two things extra. And the question pattern is different. There is no word limit, actually. So it's expected that for a 20 marks question, you'll write around 3.5 to 4 pages and accordingly. So at least for 2022, 40 marks questions, two subparts, say around 7 to 8 pages. Rest all same, introduction, conclusion and all these things. So we'll also have a separate answer writing program for WBCS and we'll be launching it soon after the prelims results, WBCS prelims results. Not required, actually. This is about answer writing. You can refer to any one book and you can start practicing answer writing with this program, Shubham. And wherever you find, like, say in a particular question, your question will be evaluated. Say you read about G.S. Gure or you read about Marx or Durkheim and then you start writing these answers that will be given to you. And whatever your doubts, the place where you're getting stuck or your answer is not... Ravi, I'll come to your question. And then I think then you start writing the answer, Shubham. And whatever are your doubts, how to write a good answer, how to address that topic, say on Durkheim on religion, for example, how to write that, that you will get in the form of model answers. So you can easily prepare from that and you can go. Rahul, I guess you have done with your basics and you have studied, your syllabus is complete. Now is the time for answer writing. So you have to write more and more answers. So you can join this program and you can practice answer writing. You get your answers evaluated. Unless you get your answers. Predict answers. Predict questions. See, major current affairs questions you will be dealt with in the program. But how can I predict the paper that this is surely going to come? Like, I don't have a secret key to UPSC's mind. State, I think WBCS is open to all. It's not, there's no state reservation. Any other questions? Any other questions, guys? I guess no other questions. And okay, I hope the session was useful. You got some important, relevant fodder, how to go about with sociology answer writing. Great. So I think you should, so we are offering this course at a very affordable price. You go to the market, you'll see programs are very... Yes. You'll be given model answers on previous year questions also. In fact, you'll be made to write some previous year questions and then we'll provide model answers, discussion videos, everything. Thank you, Gaikwad, Aishwarya. Thank you. Thank you so much. It was absolutely wonderful for addressing you people as well. And thank you, Preeti. So I think you should, it's at a very affordable price. It's not at all expensive or something. In the market, you have 30,000 around packages. So I think you should start at whatever stage of your preparation you are, you should join the program. And for 1 week, we are keeping it free. Where can I get the details of the program? Are you part of the Diademy Sociology group? Ravi? If you join the Diademy Sociology group, yes, you'll get mentorship, absolutely. You will be, okay. Then I think the details will be posted there, how you can join, joining link and everything. Okay. Yes, on that Telegram channel. You'll be thoroughly guided how to write answers and all these things. Okay, thank you guys, thank you. Any other queries? Any other queries? Okay, sure. Okay then, all the best. Keep studying, working hard and do write answers and studying sociology and all these things and build an interest in sociology, just not for the sake of writing the paper, but do build a grip. Only you can, if you develop an interest, only then you can have a grip. Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody.